We are here tonight because 50 years ago today, Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. stepped to a podium right here in Riverside Church and delivered a sermon that he knew would rock the world and lead to a wave of condemnation and vilification by many of his friends and close political allies. He did. The sermon that he gave that day is rarely mentioned on the national holiday that is named in his honor. It's rarely mentioned during Black History Month. And yet it seems fair to say that 50 years later, it is this sermon that has proved the most prophetic. It is this sermon, far more than the I Have a Dream speech, that speaks most directly to the current moral and political crises that we face today. Yes. The speech delivered in April 1967, exactly 1 year before his assassination. And at the time he delivered this speech, there was a horrific war raging in Vietnam, and it had been raging for years. American soldiers were returning home in caskets, and these images were broadcast on the evening news. Our military began using napalm, chemical warfare, on women, children, entire villages. Bombs containing napalm dropped on villages, and photographic images of women and children burning alive, running from their villages, were being circulated around the globe. During the Vietnam War, 8 million tons of bombs were dropped on that small country, all in the name of fighting communism. A peace movement was growing and surging in the United States, and some clergy were beginning to speak out. Pressure had been building on King to speak by those in the peace movement, and many young activists, like Stokely Carmichael, began to pressure King to speak out. You've got to break your silence. Even Muhammad Ali had taken his stand. He announced that as a Muslim, he was a conscientious objector, and that he would rather go to jail than fight that war. He famously said, quote, "No Vietnamese ever called me a nigger. They never lynched me. They didn't put no dogs on me. They didn't rob me of my nationality, rape and kill my mother and father. Shoot them for what? How can I shoot those poor people? Just take me to jail." And still King remained silent. King actually wanted to break his silence years earlier, but members of his inner circle, many of his closest friends and advisors, said no, begged him not to. They were afraid. They knew what the response would be. They knew there would be a vicious backlash, that he would be cast as a communist and as a traitor. And it would be an enormous setback for a movement that was really just beginning. Civil rights leaders didn't want King criticizing President Lyndon Johnson. It was the last thing they wanted. For many of them, Johnson had been the best president Black people ever had. He signed the Voting Rights Act, the civil rights legislation, and he was promising to be an ally in the fights to come. What kind of madness, many of them said, would lead you to antagonize the president who has been a friend to Black people, who just signed the civil rights legislation we've been fighting for and some of us died for? And so when King stepped to the podium here in Riverside Church, he began his speech by saying, "I am here tonight because my conscience leaves me no other choice." And Dr. Vincent Harding was given the task of drafting the speech, a man who I have to say, became a dear friend to me in the last years of his life. He's a man whose spiritual and moral depth rivals anyone I have ever known. And this sermon that he drafted with King could have merely taken issue with the Vietnam War, but it went much, much further, challenging the greed and imperialism of American empire and calling out the United States government as the greatest purveyor of violence in the world. The entire sermon is grounded in King and Harding's deeply held spiritual belief that Vietnamese children were children of God, no less than American children, and no less than the young black men who were being drafted and sent to kill them. Every effort was made to ensure that this message would actually be heard by people of faith and conscience around the world. A decision was made that this message would not be delivered at a huge protest in March that was going to be occurring 10 days later at the United Nations. There was fear that if he were to deliver his remarks there, that they would get mixed up in the angry crowd and the political messaging, and that the message would be corrupted or lost or distorted and confused in the media. And so Dr. King and his advisor said, we need to give this speech at Union, at Riverside, in a place of worship. The next day, 168 newspapers denounced him, and President Johnson disinvited him from the White House. The New York Times called the speech wasteful and self-defeating. The Washington Post said that Dr. King had done a discredit to himself, to his people, to his country, and that he would no longer be a respected man in America. And the American public turned against him. The last poll taken in his life, the Harris poll, found that 75% of the American people had turned against King on this issue, including a majority of black folks. Now, I encourage all of you who are here tonight to read the sermon, to read the whole thing. Read it at least twice, and then ask yourself whether or not this exact same sermon could be delivered today with even greater force and resonance. We might need to change a few words. Change Vietnam to Iraq and Afghanistan. Might need to tweak it here or there. But I believe that speech, that sermon, has more resonance today than it did 50 years ago when it was delivered. And if that's true, I think that tonight, in our conversation, we have to ask ourselves what we must do now to build that global revolution that Dr. King insisted was overdue 50 years ago. Now, I want to turn to Ruby Sales and give her a chance to frame this moment for us. Ruby, you were alive back then. I wasn't born yet, but you were not only alive, but you were an activist already. You were a teenager putting yourself and your life on the front lines of this movement. At the time this sermon was delivered, you had already been arrested for nonviolent, direct action protesting segregation. You participated in a march after you were released from jail, where a white supremacist threatened your life, pointed a gun at you, and a white seminary student pushed you out of the way and took the bullet that was intended for you and died. And the killer of that young man was acquitted by an all-white jury. And so you, as much as anyone, know what was at stake in that moment in time when the sermon was delivered, what sacrifices had been made for the limited gains that had been won. And I wonder if you can just take us back for a moment to that place in history, how you felt, what you believed about the sermon, and what you believe its significance is for us at this moment in time.
Thank you very much. Let me just say before I begin that conversation, let me start another conversation by thanking you very much for the framework that you've offered, the optic that you've given us to really deepen, as Dr. Harding would say, our understanding of the sermon, It's Time to Break Silence. I also would like to thank the staff of Riverside Church, Olive Seminary, and the Veterans of Hope for the prophetic wisdom and vision to gather us in this sister and brother circle 50 years after this sermon to deepen our understanding of this sermon in a society that has been mortally wounded by materialism, racism, and militarism, and might I add to that, heterosexism and misogyny. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It is not by happenstance that we gather in this magnificent edifice 50 years later to really ask a fundamental question that gave birth to the Break the Silence sermon: where do we go from here, community or chaos? It is important for us, as we think about this sermon, that we filter it through the quadruple lens of hindsight, insight, foresight, and metasight. Yes. Dr. Martin Luther King and Dr. Vincent Harding had their feet grounded in insight, deeply perceptive with hindsight, and understanding that the record would be everlasting and transcendental. And so it is from this perspective, from this front porch, that we examine this question. I also want to say that Dr. Harding and Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King had been a part of a movement that had broken through the Iron Curtain of white supremacy and had turned around a nation, had decimated an empire that had lasted for more than 400 years. And ordinary black people and white people throughout this nation destabilized that empire without firing a shot. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As we move forward, Michelle has asked me, what did that time mean? And for me, it was a very important time that challenged my own classism, because I had grown up in a society where I was told that educated people should be the legitimate leaders and the definers of the direction of African American people. The Southern Freedom Movement turned that upside down and set it right again, because it was a Kairos moment were ordinary people like John Hewlett, Fannie Lou Hamer, Miss Devine, Victoria Gray Adams, Ruby Sales had the public microphone. It was a prophetic moment in Black church history where Black women in Baptist churches stood in the pulpit and theologically talked about the concept of justice as a spiritual concept. It was an important moment. And not only did it destabilize white supremacy, but it destabilized classism and colorism in the Black community. Mm-hmm. So for a young girl coming from Columbus, Georgia, who was pretty much a rebel, pretty much a wild person in her youth, drinking wine at the pond at Tuskegee, swimming naked with the boys at Tuskegee, and suddenly trying to figure out, because I thought I was a beatnik, so I was trying to find my place in the world. And then I ended up in this class with a woman named Jean Wiley, and she introduced me to James Baldwin. Nobody knows my name. And suddenly, I had a name, and it was Black. It was woman. And I also got a new religion, and that religion was civil rights. And I went down in Lowndes County, Alabama, and I was a peasant. I didn't know anything about movement history. What I did know is that I had grown up in a society, in a community at Carver High School, where my principal and all of our teachers and everyone in our community told us to aim high. And they told us there had to be a connection between our career and the destiny of our people. And so I was part of a community project that began in 1865 when Black men gathered in Selma immediately after the Emancipation Proclamation to pledge their utmost endeavors to educate our youth for the advancement of the race and for the preservation of our rights and liberties. And it was with that spirit that I went to Lowndes County, Alabama, and was deeply moved. Janet Moses is here. She was in Lowndes County with us. Deeply moved by the power of ordinary people, sharecroppers, who, in their words, didn't know an A from a bullfrog, would shake the foundations and the roots of this nation, would create a spirit, would fertilize and ferment and unleash a spiritual movement in this country that would offer an alternative narrative to empire religion and create a liberating God that was on the side of the poor, a liberating God that set forth for us a call to justice. And I was deeply moved by being a part of that community. And although I was young and didn't really see myself as believing, as being a part of that spiritual movement, because every time Black people gathered and prayed, I thought they were being ridiculous. I couldn't understand why we couldn't just get down to the business of the meeting. Why did we have to waste everybody's time with all that old-fashioned back-in-the-day stuff? But I began to understand that it was that spiritual grounding that gave Black people the courage to be able to face dogs and billy clubs and torture and not be afraid. It was that spiritual grounding that allowed them to say, even in the face of segregation, even in the face of one of the most brutal empires in history, they were able to say, I love everybody. I love everybody in my heart.
You know, Ruby, when we were preparing to meet for this dialogue, we were on a conference call with a number of people involved in the planning, and everyone, including me, kept referring to it as the Beyond Vietnam speech. And you interrupted, and you said, no, it's a sermon. And we all said, oh yeah, it's a sermon. And then we kept talking, and then somebody would call it a speech, and someone else would call it a speech, and we kept defaulting to calling a speech. And you interrupted us, I don't know, 3-4 times, and said, it's a sermon. And I was struck by that, and I went back and reread the sermon, and I saw why you said that. And I wonder if you would just share a little bit with us now about why you felt it was so critically important to keep at the center an understanding that this wasn't just a political speech, but a sermon calling us to a spiritual revolution, not merely a political one.
Yes. First and foremost, Dr. Martin Luther King said in that sermon that, yes, I'm a civil rights leader, but I come to you tonight, he said, as a preacher. And he came before this congregation not only as a preacher, but as a preacher who had been deeply steeped and clothed in black folk theology. It was a theology that began in the Bush harbors of sites of terror in this country that have been called plantations. It was a theology that offered an alternative to empire theology that said that God was on the side of white supremacy, a theology that said that God was on the side of materialism, a theology that said that in God we trust as they raised the flag of militarism. It was black people created a theology that was essential to redeem the souls of America. It was a theology that said that I am somebody, that my somebodyness is not rooted in what I own, what I possess, or who I possess. It was an alternative theology in a society of materialism, in a society where genocide have been the calling card of people who call themselves pioneers. It was a society that had birthed and bred the extermination of indigenous people in this country, the Trail of Tears, the breaking up of families. It was a theology that humanized this society. And Americans owe a great deal to black folk theology. So it was this black folk theology that influenced our belief that there was a correlation between justice, the spiritual nature of justice, and democracy. It was a spiritual message because it dealt with our inner and our outer lives as individuals and as a nation. It was a spiritual message because it moved us beyond tribalism to nationhood and universalism. It was a spiritual message because it forced us to not only critique ourselves, but also to look out in the world and critique how we dealt with other people. I think that it's really important as we look at the, also it was a spiritual message because it put God at the center of our existence. It moved us from white supremacy, where white supremacy is idolatry, where the guardians of white supremacy want us to believe that they are God. They want us to believe that they are the Alpha and Omega of our beginning. They want us to believe that we owe all of our allegiance to them. And most importantly, they want to dismember us. They want us to believe that they gave us our freedom. They want us to believe that we should go out in the world and be foot soldiers on their behalf. And Dr. Martin Luther King cut through all of that and reminded us that we were children of God, of a universal God, and that we were connected across geography, across all of the social divides that separate us in the world. It was a mountaintop spiritual message that called us to a Pentecost moment, that called us to a world house.
And wouldn't you say that it was his spiritual commitment that brought him to break his silence? Because if he were to honor his political commitments, he would have remained silent. He would have done what was politically smart in the moment, which was to stay quiet and to build a relationship on the relationship that he had with Lyndon Johnson, that if he was going to do what was politically wise for him and for the movement at the time, it would not have been to speak out on Vietnam at the time. And instead, it was because he had a higher moral and spiritual commitment that led him to do something that was very much inconvenient for the movement and for the politics of the time.
Well, I think Martin Luther King had always been the inconvenient hero. Mm-hmm. When he stood flat-footed in Dexter Avenue Baptist Church and spoke out against Southern apartheid in a land that had created lynching and castration and rape and enslavement, and dared to go against the grain of that society and to envision a democracy and to preach from the pulpit about this democracy and to talk about it as a justice as a spiritual call that we should allow to be at the cornerstone of any movement. His movement was not a materialist movement, Michelle, and I think we make a terrible mistake when we make the Vietnam speech to be his defining moment. It was part of an evolutionary process that began the moment he stepped his feet on the pulpit and became a movement leader at Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. So yes, but it was not at this moment that he was politically.
It wasn't the only moment.
Right, sure. He was always out taking positions that went against the political grain. Mm-hmm. And that was his genius, and that was his relevancy to the moment. Mm-hmm. Be ye not conformed. He was not conforming to a political norm. Now, Roger Wilkins and people like that were more in line with the political norm, but he was a prophet, so always outside of the political norm, because there's not one moment that a prophet is not prophesizing against the empire.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, one of the things, you know, in rereading his sermon that leapt out to me was that it was a challenge, really, for all of us to break our silences. That we all, in our personal lives, in our families, in our communities, in our politics, have silences that we ought to break. And it caused me to reflect, even in my own life, about those times when I have remained silent too long, and what it takes to muster the courage to break those silences. Certainly when I chose to write my book, it was an effort to break silence. I was concerned about the silence that existed in the civil rights community as a war on drugs was ravaging poor communities and communities of color and relegating millions of people to a permanent second-class status. And when I finally woke up, I looked around and saw that too many other people were remaining silent as well, and I wanted to find a way to try to break that silence. But in my work, traveling and speaking and talking about mass incarceration and working with communities that have been devastated by mass criminalization, I've come to recognize there are other silences I must break as well.
Yes.
And that there's reasons why we stay silent so long. I had an experience right here at Riverside when I was beginning, well, I guess it was sort of the middle of my own travels with the book, and I gave a speech about the evils of mass incarceration and what must be done. And at the end of my talk, a young man came up to me with a small handwritten note and handed it to me. And I read it, opened it up, and I read the contents inside, and he said something to the effect of, "Dear Sister Michelle, what can we do to support you in speaking the truth about the relationship between mass incarceration, global capitalism, and American empire?" And I was so grateful for the note, not only because he was challenging me and calling me to speak a truth I had known for a while, I need to find a way to speak, but also the way in which he delivered the message. Because there are many ways we can challenge each other. We can challenge each other through criticism and condemnation, or we can say to one another, "How can we support you in rising to higher ground?" And when I think about Vincent Harding and his relationship to Dr. King, I can see how he was someone who in King's life supported him in rising to higher ground, and being there as someone who could support him in breaking the silences he knew he needed to break. And so I've been thinking about, in the context of this sermon today, what are the silences we need to break now? What are the silences that we need to break 50 years after this sermon? And I certainly believe that in white communities, there are certain silences that must be broken. I talk to many white people who say, "Oh, my family's crazy. Half of them are voting for Trump." I said, "Oh, so what did you say to them?" "Oh, we don't talk about it." "We don't talk politics. That's uncomfortable." There are silences around racism, silences around white supremacy. There are silences in our national community about the wars we're waging abroad. We never see on the evening news American soldiers coming home in their caskets. We never see the bodies of those who are laid waste by drones. And this creates silences that must be broken. And in the black community, the African American community, I see silences. Silences around homophobia. Silences around even incarceration today. Say, "Well, we don't talk about the time he did behind bars. We don't talk about what went on then. We don't talk." So I'm very curious about what you believe are some of the silences that need to be broken. Today, the Trump administration wants to create silence about climate change as American empire gears up to even greater levels of exploitation and extraction of our natural resources and degradation of a planet. There's an attempt to create silence. So what do you believe are the silences that we must break today?
I believe that we must break the silence of revisionist history. We must be able to make a connection between the world that we are witnessing today and the world that has always been in this country. Mm-hmm. Michelle talked a little bit about her work, the New Jim Crow and mass incarceration. That's a system of containment. And containment existed with mass incarceration, but it's always been a tool of oppression. During enslavement, there was a system of containment. So we have to begin to make a connection. Surveillance is also another important tool of oppression that exists today, that existed during the New Jim Crow, that existed during mass incarceration, that has deep roots in this country. And so oftentimes I hear politicians say, this is not what America is about. And I wonder, what history book have they been reading? Because I think it's important. For example, we see a situation with immigrants today where there's a proposal to break up families. And people step back in absolute horror, as if we'd never been there before. And I'm thinking, don't you understand what happened when people came to this country and unleashed genocide on Native American peoples? Don't you understand what happened when indigenous people's children were taken away from them and put in boarding schools, forced to adapt to a Western culture and leave their own culture behind? Don't you understand when children during enslavement were ripped out of the bosom of their families and were property of men and women who had the option to sell them at whim? This is deep. The fragmentation of relationships and the destruction of community is a very deep imprint on the tracks of white American history. This is not new today. Yes, that happened in Vietnam, but it also happened on the streets of America during the Southern Freedom Movement when black people were gassed and tear gassed. This country has a long history of chemical warfare against its people. That's not new either. We see evidence of that chemical warfare in leaded water in Flint, Selma, Jackson, Mississippi. Yes. My sisters and brothers, that is chemical warfare with biological consequences. So what I think we have to do is to break the silence of our own lies. And we have to begin to speak truth, because it's only by facing America to come to grips with its sordid history that we can begin to continue to bring into being what Vincent Harding calls a nation that is yet to be born. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, even as we break the silence on that part of history, we must also break the silence on that part of American history that gives us hope. There have always been deviants, whether they were abolitionists, whether they were enslaved people who created the first movement in this country. You're not taught that it was a movement. You call them runaway slaves. But that was a movement. That was the first movement on Southern soil in this country, the runaway slave movement. And so I think there have always been deviants, there have always been people of color who've been willing to step out and join hands to upbuild democracy in this country. And their stories are as important as the stories of white supremacy, because it's, and we must include in those stories not just exceptional people like Martin Luther King, but ordinary people like our grandmothers and our grandfathers and our uncles and our aunts.
Yes. Yes. I'm wondering if you think that one of the silences that needs to be broken revolves around the nature of the change that's required. It seems to me that there has been for a very long time, particularly in civil rights communities, a narrative of progress that revolves around a notion that if only we just keep plodding along on this path that we're on, filing another lawsuit, electing another good Democratic politician, lobbying the right people, that if we just keep doing more of what we have been doing over the last couple of decades, that eventually, kind of we'll get to the promised land. And it seems to me that breaking the silence around the nature of what is required in this moment, and for me that means being willing to say out loud that we need revolutionary change in this country. And we need, as King said, a revolution that is spiritually grounded, but not in a way that's reduced to a Hallmark card. You know, the phrase revolution of values itself, when divorced from the sermon itself, can sound as though, you know, what King was talking about was, well, we should all just be a lot kinder to one another, that we should just see the good in others and recognize that we're all God's children. Right. And, you know, isn't that a wonderful feeling we ought to have towards one another? And yet when you read through the sermon and you see when he calls for the revolution of values, he actually spends a very long time before he gets to that line in his sermon, outlining the ways in which American empire has consistently aligned itself against revolutions, attempted revolutions of poor people and oppressed people who are trying to throw off colonialism and the ravages of capitalism. And again, the United States violently tries to crush those uprisings, aligning itself with brutal dictators. And the revolution that King calls for in that speech is a literal one. He is asking us to align ourselves with the global revolutions that are underway around the world to throw off empire, imperialism, and colonialism. But he's calling then for this revolution to be a spiritually grounded one, a revolution of values, and saying that a true revolution has to have that spiritual component. And I worry that many people embrace the language of King without fully understanding the implications of what he was calling for, that this wasn't a rhetorical revolution, it wasn't a metaphorical revolution. He was asking for the radical restructuring of the political, social, and economic systems in the United States and around the world in a way that would be spiritually and morally grounded.
But I think that it's even deeper than that, because he was asking us to imagine a revolution of values that did not come about with the butt of a shotgun.
Mm-hmm.
He was asking us to have a new disciplined revolution, a nonviolent revolution, where love would be the calling card and action would be the staple in the revolution. And so that I think that it's really very important for us to as we think about a revolution of values, and as we think about it against the backdrop of the society that we're living in today, we must understand that we're up against some very powerful forces, as exemplified by Donald Trump and Steve Bannon, and the global white supremacist culture warriors in the White House. They talk about a Muslim ban, but that's just coded word for a war on black and brown people. I think we're out of time, so I just want to say one closing remark that is really important that I wanted to share with you as you go forward tonight. We are living in very unprecedented times. Yes, we have had presidents who were white supremacists, and yes, we've had congresspeople who were white supremacists, and yes, we've had Supreme Court justices who were white supremacists, but this is the first time in history where we have had card-carrying white supremacists who've captured three branches of the government, who have made it very clear that they are going to depopulate this world of black and brown people because of our growing demographics, and that they will use any means necessary to do it. We are in a phase in our society where we must begin to forge a spiritual revolution, where we must begin to reorder our society from the inside out and from the inside in. And we must move from a tribal God to a universal God. And we must stand flat-footed and say that, as Rosemarie Hardin often said, that this is our country and we won't let the white supremacists have it.
We'll begin with a question that came to us over Twitter. We've heard you speak so amazingly about the implications of this global revolution that Dr. King called for today. Can you give us our marching orders?
You must meet in groups, you must talk with each other, and you must come together, and you must bring to bear your own thinking and your own knowledge and your own commitment to the question of building up a more perfect union in this country and around the globe.
I'm also a veteran of the civil rights movement, and I do believe that it's possible for us to continue to fight this global white supremacist power structure by using some of the same tactics that we use in the civil rights movement. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Michelle, I'll let you have it.
Well, I think that's absolutely right. I think the power of nonviolent civil disobedience is as great today as it was then. And in fact, what we've seen, I think, with some of the movement work that's been done by Black Lives Matter and other organizations and activists around the country, we see that when people take to the streets in a nonviolent way and refuse to cooperate with injustice, you can capture the attention of the world and force a public dialogue that the nation might not otherwise be interested in having. There are countless ways in which, for example, mass incarceration can be thwarted through non-cooperation with injustice. And I won't list them all here now, but for example, you know, there are organizers in Southern California right now who are helping to build support networks so that people can actually
insist on their right to trial when arrested for a misdemeanor offense. If everyone who is arrested insists on their right to trial, it will disrupt the system to such a degree that it would be impossible to function. But people need resources and support in developing these kinds of systems of nonviolent civil disobedience. Insisting on your Sixth Amendment right to trial isn't an act of disobedience, it's asserting right. a constitutional right that you have by law. But there are ways in which we can refuse to cooperate with our systems of injustice. And I think, for example, the sanctuary movement is an excellent example of that, where we are organizing in communities, large and small, to ensure that Empire will not have its way in, you know, sweeping in and arresting people and deporting them to countries where they are unsafe and destroying families in those ways. Do you want to add?
Well, I just quickly want to add one thing. Intimacy is key to any movement.
Yes.
One of the ways in which Empire continues to have power is to separate us from each other and destroy how we know each other, and we become strangers. So movement must be predicated on eye-to-eye organizing. A movement cannot be built on Twitter. Any movement with efficacy must build authentic leaders from the ground up. It should not be built around a cult of a hero. It must be built around ordinary people who, once the hero is dead, the ordinary people will be equipped to move forward.
And I would like to add to one more point to that, which is that, you know, there is more than one way to vote. You know, in a democracy, I think we have been, this democracy, we've been conditioned to imagine that we have power on a few days maybe out of the year or out of a cycle of years, and that when we show up at the voting booth, that's our chance to have our say. But there are more than one way to vote, and people who are formerly incarcerated and who have lost their right to vote have demonstrated that it's possible to still exercise enormous political power through organizing, through advocacy, through speaking out, through organizing boycotts. We have economic power as well as political power, and I think the time is overdue for us to begin to think more creatively about how we use all the forms of economic, political, and social power that we have.
Using the word insistence, I like using that word preferably to the word resistance. The question that comes forward to me is, unfortunately, I see a lot of fragmented movements within groups of everyone fighting for their rights based on their histories. You know, with the first people, with people of color. The Hispanic people are very quiet in some respects in this country. So do you have, I'm trying to look towards vision of how we bring unity to each of us, not so much spending so much time on fighting what our history has done to us and moving us forward into a unity of intimacy, like you're saying, and trusting that we know the connections we have are stronger than the connections of the white supremacy.
First of all, movement cannot be separated from history.
Yes.
It is because of our history that we do movement. And so we must be able to create a new paradigm for the 21st century that harmonizes our particular experiences with universality. We must be able to talk about our experiences as African Americans, our experiences as women, our experiences as LGBTQ people. We must be willing to talk about, because once you say to people that history doesn't matter, then what is the foundation of a movement?
Yes.
And so it's not an either or. I do believe that we must begin to imagine new ways and a new language for building movement of the 21st century. We must move away from trite words like white privilege. To be perfectly honest, as a black woman, I'm privileged. So privilege is the wrong word. We must begin to talk about rights, that what we're after are rights, not privilege. We don't want to enjoy the corruptness of privilege. What worries me, not that we talk about our particular histories, but is our inability to talk about the histories of others and to be able to touch our common connections. That's problematic for me.
I have a hard time understanding why the histories of suffering in this nation are experienced as divisive.
Mm. As what?
As divisive.
Right.
I want to know the history of indigenous people in this land. I want to know about how people who are called Mexican today lost their land here in the United States. Yes. I want to know that history. I want to know the history of colonialism. I want to know the history of genocide. I want to better understand the varied and rich histories that have brought people to this moment in time. And I think when we try to erase that history or ask people to remain silent about their histories, we actually make the potential of a multiracial, multi-ethnic, egalitarian democracy impossible. It is only by facing our history and opening our hearts and opening our minds to the suffering and the joys and the beauty and the terrors of all people, of all colors, no matter who you are, where you've come from, or what you may have done, that we have any hope of birthing a nation that truly treats all of us as though our lives matter. There is no other way than facing our individual and collective histories if we're going to learn from that history and build a real egalitarian democracy in this country and support the kind of revolutions around the world that I dream of and I believe many of us dream can be possible.
Well, let me just add one thing. I'm very suspicious when people start saying that, because what they're really saying, they're asking people of color, women, to erase our histories. It's a sly way of wanting us to be invisible, saying that when we speak our histories, then we are dividing the nation. And if we don't speak our history, then whose history will we speak? And so I think we must caution against this tendency to want to erase the histories of people of color.